Okay, welcome to another Orbiter 2010 video, and this video is going to be a continuation in the Mars to Earth series that I'm doing. I say series, but it's really just going to be probably a couple of videos because we're focusing mostly on the execution of the flight and not worrying so much about like all the transect setup and everything. We actually will be using IMFD for most of our navigation, but I set up the plan to go back to Earth here on the ground using transects, just because I'm still a little bit more familiar with it. And the part of the plan that just gets you from the ground up to orbit isn't real. Transects does just as good of a job as IMFD does, so we can use what we're familiar with and then kind of merge in IMFD as we learn more about it. Now, let me go ahead and switch camera views here because I sometimes forget to do that if I don't do it early. What we're looking at here in burn time calculator, I put in the external fuel mass, which is the 804 that we have in the RCS, and that gives us a total delta V of 6,216. Now bear in mind that we are on Mars and there is some amount of atmosphere here. It's very thin, but there is some atmosphere. So this number is actually a little bit lower than what it would be if we were in space. And it's only like 7 meters per second. It's almost the same. But that's just because our engine ISP is slightly lower than it would be. In fact, if we kind of look at our plan, if we look at the spreadsheet, our calculation says that we would have 6,223 meters per second at the start of the mission. And we have 6,216. So again, it's only a difference of like 7 meters per second. We, however, do not have enough delta V to complete the injection burn if we don't transfer the fuel from the RCS over to the main. Now, if the main tank was at 100%, we would actually have to burn off some of that fuel first, then do the RCS transfer. But since we have only 50% in the main, we can go ahead and take care of that fuel transfer now, and it's probably a good idea because it's easy to forget. So I'm just going to bring the RCS all the way down to about 10%. We do need some RCS for orbital maneuvering and translation. That's figured into the calculation. Wrong button. So we might end up transferring some back over to the RCS, but most of it needs to be in the main. Now we have 239 days worth of locks. And again, if we look at our plan that we set up, we said that we were going to need 237 days plus an additional, we're giving ourselves a 2-day window for, in case we don't get back as quick as we think we will. And I think that's pretty much it for the setup. We can pretty much go right away. Let me just make sure that I have everything set up how I want. So we don't need this from BTC. And of course this now says 6.9 because it's including all that external fuel mass, but we transferred most of it over to the main. Make sure orbit MFD set up how I want it is. Make sure that we have launch MFD loaded so that we know when to go. And the time to intersection is the time that we need to leave. Normally you would leave from Earth when the time to intersection was like 300 seconds because it takes about 10 minutes to get to orbital velocity on Earth. And you want to leave when your time to intersection is half of the amount of time that it takes to reach orbital velocity. On Mars, we get to orbital velocity much faster. It's actually like 3 minutes, a little over 3 minutes. So we only need to leave when the time to the intersection is only like 115 seconds or so. Now, one other thing, it's actually the best way to get to orbit on Mars, because it does have some kind of an atmosphere, is to take off at a 90 degree heading and fly out taking advantage of the lift that you get from the XR2 or whatever vessel you're flying. But I think, and I haven't done comparisons on this yet, but I think in this case, we're going to be better off lifting up off the ground and rotating using the hover engines, lifting up off the ground and then rotating, because our heading is so different. We need to have a heading of 16 degrees. You can see that here in launch MFD. It's 15.94. That's the heading that we need to have. And you can't steer in the atmosphere on Mars until you're traveling like 800, 900 meters a second, up to 1,000 meters a second. So that would mean that we would take off and we would fly, at the 90-degree heading, and then we would have to bank very steeply. And I think that's going to be, I think that would be less fuel efficient than just lifting up, hovering for just a few seconds and rotating over and then blasting the main engines. Now, ideally, I guess if we had a runway that was actually at 16 degrees, that would be the way to go. But in this case, our runway is at a, is a, only has 90 or 270 as its possible headings, and we don't want to just fly arbitrarily across the ground, although you can in order because there's no terrain. But we'll try to keep things semi-realistic. So I actually placed the XR2 on the runway, thinking that I was going to fly out the runway heading, but really I could have just left it on the landing pad. All right, now let's get a little bit closer to the time to the intersection. And actually, now that I'm talking, I'm warm enough, so I'm gonna go ahead and take my jacket off before we get going too far. You never see me wearing jackets or long sleeves because I live in Florida, but it's so freaking cold here today. It was super warm yesterday too. That's the weird thing. I had the doors and windows open yesterday, but we had some kind of cold front move through overnight, apparently. All right, let's get warp time forward. Okay, it's almost time to go. Let's get a little bit closer than that even. All right, that's good enough. Now I'm going to bring up orbit MFD on this side, and we're going to start the APU, open the hover doors.
Offline.
And we're going to set
Rotation.
rotation and turn off external cooling.
Using onboard O2.
Still haven't made my checklist yet. Talk about it all the time I need to, but I still haven't made it. I just go by what I remember. All right, so we need a heading of about 16 degrees. So let's lift up.
Wheels up.
Raise the landing gear.
Gear up.
Rotate over to 16 degrees. And you can see how fast you rotate.
Gear up and
That's
lock.
why I think that this is probably more efficient than flying the runway heading and trying to bank over to. Okay, there we go. Full power on the main. And let's set pitch to 40 degrees initially. Eliminate the hover. Close the hover doors. Now we'll pitch up initially at 40 degrees just to get up, out of the relatively thick atmosphere. Of course, the Martian atmosphere is very thin, but once we're up to about 10 kilometers, then we're going to just go to a pitch of like 1.5, let the vessel come back down, because otherwise we'll reach an APA of 200 and really fast, and we don't want that. We want to get some horizontal speed. Start slowly bringing down the pitch. And I don't know what the ideal ascent profile is for this type of flying. I don't. We did a whole Mars orbit exercise thing on Orbiter Forum a while back, and we found that definitely it was definitely best to take off like an airplane. That
Mach
it's more it's cheaper
six.
to do that than it is to hover up. But again, since I have this awkward heading, that's why I'm using the hover. But beyond what I
Warning, Mach RCS fuel low. System
beyond what
reset.
I learned in the Mars orbit exercise, I don't really know otherwise what the ideal heading or ideal launch profile is.
Eight.
Okay, so watching relative inclination, it's not coming down very fast, and then back that up a little bit there. So I'm gonna say I think I'm too far banked to the. I don't think I brought the heading around quite enough. So I'm gonna put in some bank angle while I can, because there's not much atmosphere left. It gets really thin when you get above 40. So unfortunately, I'm probably going to have a relatively high relative inclination when I get to orbital velocity, or rather when my APA gets to 200, because that's gonna happen much sooner than reaching orbital velocity. Yeah, relative inclination is only down to 2.5, man. I really should just do this whole heading's coming around in the wrong direction too. Yikes, I'm actually tempted to refly the you know what, I'm gonna refly the launch. This is my relative inclination's too high. I don't have enough fuel to have that kind of a mistake, I don't think. Well, we can find out.
Mach 15.
So bank is zero. I'll know when I get up to do the insertion burn whether or not I can go forward. Okay, we're Mach at one. 16. Here we go. Turn that off. And we can open the radiator now even because I didn't bring my heading around enough. So we have a 2-degree relative inclination, and I can actually calculate what that's going to cost me. So while we're getting up to apoapsis, let me actually just run a quick calculation here. It's easy. The change plane calculation, we're at Mars, and we have a 2.304 relative inclination, and our apoapsis is 199.1, and our periapsis is -718. So it would cost me about 128 meters per second. I can't fly this plan. I didn't leave myself enough margin for error. So let me exit out of orbiter, and we're just going to redo that launch. It won't take long because I don't have to explain anything. So Mars to Earth. So this time I just need to be more careful that I get the heading. Sometimes when I do these videos, I'm pretty good, I think, at talking while flying orbiter, but it does require a certain amount of concentration to be able to talk, and some of that concentration makes me make certain mistakes in orbiter that I wouldn't make on my own. So let's quickly warp time forward to the time to go. And about 200 seconds, we'll take care of a couple little bits of upkeep before we take off. We have to open the hover doors and crossfeed and all that. So let's bring up orbit MFD. And we need to, let's do the crossfeed first, because that's
crossfeed main.
And we can go ahead and turn off external cooling, warp time forward to get through that quickly. And that should be good. Now start the APU.
Rotation,
hover. And we're ready to go. And actually, let me do this also. I usually do this when I'm flying myself, but I forgot to do it because I was talking. All right, now we're ready to go. Let me just quickly check launch MFD on the time one last time. Oh yeah, we're past time to go. It's so.
Wheels up.
Okay, wheels up.
Gear up. Gear up and locked.
Okay, about right there, full power on the main, and now eliminate the hover. Set the pitch, close the hover doors. And now we should be underway and then be in slightly better shape than last time, hopefully. And again, once we get up a few kilometers, we're going to start taking out some of that pitch. Because if you climb out at 40 degree pitch, you're going to end up having an APA of 200 well before you're able to bring up the other side of your orbit. So let's start taking out some of that pitch now.
Three.
I guess really about 30 degrees is what I should set it at, because we don't ever get up to 40 degree pitch before we end up taking out some of the pitch.
Mach 4.
to have a 0.5 degree up pitch here and see how that works out for us. RCS warning. I should probably set the RCS to like 6% when I do this so I don't get that warning. Okay, APA 52, relative inclination coming down. Bring up this secondary HUD. I don't really find the other one's too terribly useful. Okay, relative inclination still coming down. We're at 4.1. You can do a scram ascent on Mars in orbiter. I don't think it's realistic to do that, but you can use, you can do it. APA 62, relative inclination coming down. You can see we're already at 2.5, which is, I think, where we were at. Yeah, before it was 2.3 when we had to cut the engine, so, you know, we're much better off this time.
Mach 11.
Okay, again, watching that APA. Bring up the pitch just 1 degree because we're still a little low. Once you get above 40 kilometers, the atmosphere is basically non-existent, but it's, we're still a little low. APA 78, almost 80, and the relative inclination coming down much nicer than before. This is what we want to see. Hopefully I don't overshoot it. That's not what I want to do. I don't want to go past 0.0, but I might. All right, let's really watch our APA now, though, because yeah, we're gonna probably go past it. Yeah, we are. Okay.
Mach
60. Might be able to correct that with a little bit of right bank. Okay, APA is 199.3. We should be up high enough that we don't get any drag, maybe, and we might even get a little bit of lift. But what I really want to watch is that relative inclination. So let me open the radiator because we're high up enough for that. And let's zero out the pitch. But we want to bank this way a bit while we're still getting these trace amounts of effect from the atmosphere. That'll help bring our relative inclination down. Although since we're banked, we might not get the lift from the XR2 that we would otherwise get. And we'll just take care of that a little bit here until we get a little higher. Then we'll, you know, shut off this, close the, turn off the APU. One thing I like to do at this point, let me do this real quick. Let me go back to 0.1. Let's check burn time calculator really quick to see what our total fuel is right now. Actually, I forgot to put in the fuel mass here, 28.3. I'm really hoping that burn time calculator can be updated so that it gives you an option, like on maybe on page 2, where you can have the external, where you can have the RCS included in your calculation. Like it can be on page 2, like an on-off option, and then it can default to off because I guess a lot of people probably don't do that. But when you're trying to do these flights where, you know, you're really trying to be precise on the delta V, then you want to include your RCS in the calculation. Okay, so we have 2,422 meters per second left. I have a little flight log here that I want to use. 2,442, I think I said. Yeah. And this just helps me determine how much delta V I've used up to each point in the flight. And it's mainly for logging purposes. It's not really, this doesn't really tell me if I've got enough to keep going. This just tells me, this is just like a log, a flight log, so I know how much fuel I'm using so that on the on subsequent flights I have more accurate data. Okay, back to real time. And it doesn't really look like we're getting anything from the atmosphere here one way or the other, so let's just go ahead and disengage here so we can turn off the APU. And our next order of business is going to be, we either want to circularize or we want to align our plane, not whichever one comes first. Now I believe we're done with the two the panel here. We don't need a lot of that information anymore, so we can switch over to the larger MFDs. Let me swing the eject orientation line around to our current position, which is here, and it's 0.12. Now I want to find the lowest point, like going forward. And what this is saying is that at this point in my orbit, if I wait till I'm over here, then my relative inclination will be off by that much. And if I find that lowest number, which is about, looks like it's about right here, then at this point I can bring down my relative inclination and it'll be cheaper to do it here than it would be here. However, notice this is trending downward and I'm still 3,000 seconds away from the time to do the burn. So there's a good chance that I actually don't want to do any of correction at all, because by the time I warp time forward all the way around to the time to do the burn, the relative inclination is just probably going to continue to improve. We'll keep an eye on it. But I can calculate what it would cost to correct that much relative inclination at that point. Bring up orbit MFD, see how far we are away from the time to the apoapsis. We're 800 seconds out. And that's going to happen probably. See, this orbit line's here, this orbit line's here. We're probably going to reach apoapsis at or around the same time that we would do any plane change correction if we were going to do it. So let's see what that would cost. I have a calculator that I made thanks to Dimitri's help in teaching me this formula. We can put in our relative inclination, which is 0.087. And I can put in the periapsis, which is -402. Let's call it -403. And the apoapsis, about 197. So when I reach apoapsis, and that'll be really close to the time that I would do the plane change alignment, it would be a 5 meter per second burn. Now, again, we're probably not going to do that just because this number is trending downward, and the farther I go around, the better it's going to get. So I'll just keep an eye on it to see if it starts going in the other direction. If it starts going in the other direction, then we'll do some kind of correction. So then our next order of business, instead of the plane change alignment, is going to be to circularize our orbit. So we'll do that using interplanetary MFD, simply enough. Bring that up. Bring up the orbital maneuvers here. Switch over to the orbit HUD. And we'll warp time forward. And according to burn time calculator, the burn is going to be about 10 seconds. Of course, this time is kind of going down. It won't be accurate until we actually get closer to apoapsis. But that means that we want to start the burn when we're maybe 5 seconds out. But before we get there, we can kind of help not spend so much fuel on the alignment, that when you just hit auto burn, it's going to use the RCS to align up the crosshair.
Translation.
Rotation. And if we think about getting aligned ahead of time, we can save fuel, which we need, and we need to do that because this is a flight where I'm not giving myself any margin of error, really. So it looks like I need to rotate this way. Okay, there, we're almost lined up. And the yaw just a little bit this way. I'm just trying to save as much fuel as I can by not wasting a bunch of fuel on, you know, orbital maneuvers. When I was brand new to orbiter and I would go to the moon and do other things, I wasted so much fuel just on orienting the vessel and doing other things like that. Okay, so we're not going to be exactly at prograde, apparently. Okay, we'll go ahead and leave that position there. Warp time forward a little bit farther. Okay, it looks like our position's pretty good now. And we're gonna do the burn probably closer to 4 seconds now, because you can see this has gone all the way down to 8.2. You do want to actually press the AB button about a second or two before then. Of course, it depends on how far out of orientation you are, but we are really close, so we only need about 1 or 2 seconds for the vessel to orient. So I'm going to say then at 6 seconds, when APT is 6 seconds, I'll press the AB button. So here we go, 9, 8, 7, 6, and orienting. Okay, that takes care of the orbit circularization. Now we are coming up to 30 minutes on this part of the video, so I'm going to go ahead and end it here shortly. But before we do, let's bring up burn time calculator again, and let's check our RCS mass is now 25.9. So we'll put that in. And now according to BTC, we have 2,254 meters per second. So let's check a couple things here. For one, let's log it. So 2254, I believe it was. Yeah, 2254. So we used 188 meters per second to circularize our orbit. Now let's see that since we have that much left, we can go back to our DV calculator, and we estimated that we would need 2,000, or I shouldn't say estimated, we calculated that we would need 2,035 meters per second for the injection burn. So we have enough fuel to complete the injection burn. We calculated that we would have 189.49 meters per second left after the injection burn was complete. So we'll see how accurate that is after we actually do the injection burn. So let me go ahead and hit Control S here to save. And that'll be it for this part. If you like this part of the video, please hit the like button down below. If you didn't like it, hit the don't like button. Subscribe to the channel if you're not already subscribed and you want to be notified when I upload new orbiter videos. Check the description down below for links. I have an FAQ that a lot of people don't seem to notice, and it answers a lot of questions that people ask quite frequently. So if you're not familiar with my FAQ, please scroll all the way to the bottom of the description. Click on that, and there's some pictures in there and other things that you can read over. I will see you in the next video.